In the most recent, I guess, RBC retirement report, there is a stat that suggests that 29% of pre-retirees want to spend their time down south. But in actuality, that number is only 18%. Why do you think we're seeing fewer and fewer snowbirds go to the U.S.?
I think there's probably a number of factors involved. Certainly, health insurance and increases in health insurance are a driving factor. To get out of province or out of country, health insurance is a factor. Certainly just the expense, it's continuing to increase over time as more and more people, you know, look for snowbird destinations. So that has an important factor into it. But ultimately, I also think it's, you know, there's just additional financial pressures on our retirees to date, whether they're helping their children in retirement, lower savings environment, rates environments. So there's a number of factors, I think, that put some pressure on them that may not allow them to achieve that ideal of going down south as they'd originally hoped.
Pensions aren't as generous as they used to be. Do you think that's hurting retirement preparedness?
There's definitely a potential for that. I mean, certainly a number of the people that are retiring now may still be benefiting from some defined benefit pensions. In some cases, those defined benefit pensions have been curtailed or turned into defined contributions, which can have an impact, but definitely not as generous as they have been in the past. And so that can put a little bit more of a pinch in the pockets of our retirees.
You had mentioned low rates. Is that hurting these nest eggs?
We certainly see, you know, with our clients, you know, more and more clients tend to obviously move their investments into safer investment vehicles as they approach retirement or living in retirement. And they may be relying on more sort of fixed income products, whether it's a GIC, savings, and other vehicles. And low interest rates just means it's going to have less of that type of interest income for them to help support their lifestyle. And so that can definitely have an impact.
You had mentioned one of the factors earlier being children weighing down these boomers.
Well, we all love to help our children in times of need. And interestingly enough, it doesn't matter whether they're young or they're older. We continue to look for opportunities to help our children. And we found as part of our survey that, you know, a significant number of retirees and people aged 50 plus are helping children, whether they're 25 or they're 35, whether it's first time down payments on a mortgage or helping them with other lifestyle expenses. They're definitely helping them out, and that can obviously put a little bit of an impact on our retirees' income.
We've been hearing more and more about reverse mortgages and seniors tapping into these reverse mortgages. What have you been seeing?
Well, we definitely see that reverse mortgages are on the rise. They're still a pretty small portion of the total debts outstanding respect to our 55 plus Canadians, but they are growing quite a bit. And so it's an opportunity for clients to be able to leverage some of the equity in their home, but there may be other vehicles and ways to do that that may not have the same different trade-offs that you face within a reverse mortgage.
So when you say trade-offs, I mean, are these reverse mortgages a benefit or an asset, if you will, to seniors, or should they be steering clear of them?
I think you need to look at it on a case-by-case basis. Individuals, for certain individuals, it may be an okay vehicle for them to use if they need to tap into some equity and they don't have an ability to repay and make any interest payments or anything like that over the time when they need that money. Others may have a better solution in terms of using a home line where, you know, they can still achieve a low interest rate, but they may still have to make some interest payments on that from their retirement income, whether it's part of their pension income or other savings. So it really depends on what they can do. There's other options too for people, whether it's downsizing, where they can free up some of the equity and move into a smaller, comfortable place. So there's a number of vehicles, a number of different paths that people can choose that they should try to explore them all and understand the pros and cons of each of those before making any decision.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe the name of the report is actually Retirement Myths and Realities. What stood out for you the most?
I think there's a couple of things that stood out for us. One, probably the biggest one, was that about 55% of pre-retirees think they are going to know the retirement date more than a year in advance. But in reality, what we found from the people who had retired and took the poll, 60% of them didn't know the retirement date more than a year in advance. You know, and that can create some risks, because I think it's pretty natural for many of us to think that we have more time. We have more time to plan, more time to prepare. It's always going to be another day we can do it. But if you don't really, if it ends up that you don't knowing that date, you know, more than a year in advance, we may run out of time.
Right. Is there something else that you could draw from this report as well?
I think the other thing that was a really, really important finding for us is that 50% of pre-retirees feel that they're going to be working in retirement, that they'll go back to work in retirement. And some of them...
How accurate is that? Do they actually, like, how much of that percentage?
Well, the reality is only 11% of our retirees actually did end up going back to work. And so what was, you know, striking for us is that with so many people thinking they may go back to work in retirement, they may be relying on that as a source of income. They may be relying on that as a means to be, you know, engaged and busy in retirement. But with very, very few people actually doing it, it may not prove to be the source that they had hoped for. And, you know, in order to accomplish that, maybe they need to have done a bunch of work before retirement in terms of planning their career and planning that transition that they may not have that done. And so they'll find themselves without that opportunity as easily as they'd hoped.